You can't tell me that this map opening effect from Hogwarts Legacy didn't leave you speechless. When I first saw it, I was fully mesmerized by it. Immediately, my game dev brain turned on and I couldn't help but ask, hey, how did I create this? Since nobody answered, I decided to recreate it myself and find out. Little did I know that this decision would require overcoming a lot of unexpected challenges. If you ever wondered how an effect like this is brought to life, or if you just love seeing me suffer, stick around because this is going to be a fun ride. I started with the analysis of the effect. It looks like somebody cast a spell on a 2D map to turn it into 3D. At the beginning of the effect, the map is almost completely flat, with only the center part of the castle being partially elevated. Then, as the time goes on, the rest of the castle and the map get extruded to form their final 3D shape. The spreading of the effect resembles a circle that is growing in size over time. Of course, there's a lot more going on here, but let's try to recreate this part first. I started with the terrain since it's the largest part of the whole scene. I've created a custom terrain shader so that I could flatten its vertices just above the water level. To do that, I implemented a simple function that moves the current position of the vertex downwards to the height just above the water level. Then, I just injected this function call into the vertex shader of the terrain. There we go, the terrain is fully flattened. This was so easy. Wait, why are parts of it disappearing when I move the camera? It turns out that the CPU doesn't know that the GPU decided to move these vertices, so it still thinks that they're located at their old position. Because of that, when I move the camera close to the ground, the CPU thinks that they're outside the camera view and doesn't even set them to the GPU for rendering. To fix that, I would need to expand the bounds of the terrain so that the CPU would know the area that the terrain occupies. However, Unity doesn't allow this. You can only read the bounds of the terrain, you can't update them. So, I can't expand the terrain bounds, but I can lie to the CPU and tell him that I'm currently looking at the whole scene, even though I'm only seeing this small part of it. To do that, I modified the occlusion matrix of the camera just before it was about to cull the scene. And look at that, everything is working again. Well, hold on, why is this little number in the corner so much lower than before? Oh, right, by rendering the whole scene every frame, I just nuked half of my FPS. There has to be a better way. I went through the documentation and forums in search of answers, but I was out of luck. The Unity's terrain system is just way too enclosed for this kind of modification. So, I decided to bake the terrain into a standard mesh. I've separated the mesh into smaller parts and saved them as mesh assets. Also, I've created multiple smaller textures out of the large terrain texture. Now, I can expand the bounds of each mesh to encapsulate the flattened position. There we go, the CPU isn't removing parts of the terrain anymore, and the FPS is still holding up. With that out of the way, I restricted this effect to a certain distance from the origin of the effect and created a little script that will enable me to change this distance from the editor. Well, this is starting to look like something, but the transition from the flattened to the normal look is way too harsh. To fix that, I've implemented a gradual height interpolation at the edge of the effect. Basically, I checked the distance from the edge and slowly increased the height towards the original one as the distance increases. Wow. This made such a big difference. It started to resemble the original effect. Well, at least until I applied the same effect to the castle trees and rivers. As you can see, when they're fully flattened, a lot of visual issues occur. Since everything is flattened to the same height, the GPU doesn't know what to render. To fix this, here's my idea. I won't squish the castle fully to the ground. Instead, I will expand it just a bit so that it appears flat from afar but is still rendered above the terrain. In order for this expansion to work, the mesh needs to have a correct pivot located at the bottom. And of course, my castle parts already have the pivot correctly placed, right? They do, right? Right? Well, since I've created the castle by combining a lot of individual procedural parts, the pivots are all over the place. I just can't catch a break. After I wiped my tears with imaginary YouTube money I've earned from this video, I created a tool that collects all meshes in the hierarchy and combines them into one mesh. Then, it positions the pivot to the bottom of the mesh. Finally, it bakes the height percentage of each vertex in the mesh into one of the UV channels. Then, in the shader, I use this height percentage to offset the vertex above the terrain. Here's the result comparing the previous and current state of the mesh during the normal and squashed state. Pretty cool, right? Also, I can control the squished height of each castle part, which gives me additional control over its look. For example, I can increase the height of the towers on the Quidditch pitch, or lower the wall pieces beneath the defensive towers. Next, I've baked the same height percentage for the trees and rivers, so they would also be expanded above the terrain a bit. Everything is starting to look really good. Well, almost everything. Since I've used a simple plane to create this small lake, it's now visible above the terrain. Come on! To fix this issue, I've used a trick I've learned during my recreation of the Death Stranding's terrain scan effect. I've placed an orthographic camera vertically above the lake and rendered it as fully white into a texture. Then, I've used that texture as a visibility mask for the lake so that it fits perfectly with the terrain. With that little fix completed, let's have a look at the current state of the effect. Well, I think it looks pretty good. The height expansion looks smooth and satisfying. Of course, I'm still missing the transition from the paper texture to the normal look of the castle. At the beginning of the original effect, the whole map initially looks like an old paper. Then, during the transition, the paper look is gradually removed and the true colors of the castle are revealed. To implement this, I've created this image in Photoshop that mimics the texture of an old paper scroll. Then, in Unity, I mixed it with the original color of the object to preserve a bit of the underlying details of the original material, since I noticed that you can see the roof tiles, roads, and water lines under the paper texture in the original effect. I tweaked the influence of the normal look and the paper overlay for each material to get these results. I think that this doesn't look too bad. Next, I expanded the map opening effect to support the texture transition. I specified a distance from the edge of the effect at which the texture transition will start and another at which the transition will be completed. Between these two distances, I slowly reduced the effect of the paper overlay and increased the influence of the normal texture. This is starting to look nice, but it's looking a bit too clean. In the original effect, the edge of the transition is not a smooth circle. It's a bit wavy and noisy, which gives it a richer look. To implement that, I've added a bit of the purlin noise to the position of each fragment to break the smoothness of the edge. After tweaking the frequency and scale of the noise, I came up with something resembling the original effect. Then, I made this texture transition zone a bit darker than the rest of the environment. This sells the illusion that the paper texture is slowly disappearing instead of just immediately vanishing. Finally, after zooming in on the original effect, I've noticed they've added a bit more detail to the edge of this texture transition zone. The edge is quite noisy and detailed, it's not so smooth like mine. To support this, I've added an additional noise offset to the effect. However, this noise has a much higher frequency and a very small amplitude. Because of that, we get this kind of noisy and detailed transition. I have to say, I quite like it. The beauty of the effect is always hidden in these small details which I never noticed at first. To complete the effect, I added a simple camera movement and a black fade-out effect at the start of the transition. Let's have a look at how it all turned out. What do you think? Have I missed something obvious? Let me know in the comment section. If you enjoyed watching this recreation and want to support us in creating more content like this, check out our Patreon account. There, you get access to the source files of our projects, early access to new videos, in-depth technical breakdowns of the effects, and much more. And that's it. Thank you for your time, and I'll see you in the next one.